Moving around to my left here, we have one of our intercom boxes. This is what we use to talk to the ground or to talk to one another anywhere in the spacecraft. We have 13 of these in the spacecraft. We can merely walk up, punch the transmit button, and either talk to the ground or to one another in the spacecraft. Or we can plug our headset into the side and talk through a headset. So that's our means of communication. In front of me here, we have one of our medical experiments. This is the rotating chair. The purpose of the rotating chair is to determine the response of the vestibular system to zero gravity. And we've been doing many experiments on this to see how the balance mechanism in the inner ear is affected by weightlessness. Up here is the control panel for controlling this experiment and for making the various inputs which go down on telemetry to the ground related to the vestibular experiment. Well, let's move on around to some of our living quarters. I'll move in right now to the bunk area compartment. It's rather small, but it's adequate. The bunk is on the wall, as you notice. It's not lying horizontally as it might in on Earth, but it's fastened to the wall, so we sleep vertically. This is Al's bunk. He likes to sleep upside down because the ventilation's better. We sleep very well. We sleep 6 to 7 hours a night. We sleep very hard. It's not any problem at all getting used to sleeping in zero G. As we move on in here, you see we have some of our personal belongings. We have lockers to keep some of our clothes and other personal things in. We even have music. We have these tape recorders that we can play music anywhere in the spacecraft. We have all brought some of our favorite music along to play whenever we feel like it. And we have also have intercom boxes and sleep compartments in the event that we have a master alarm or a caution warning in the night. We can be warned and notified that we have to get up and take care of a problem. I'll see if I can demonstrate getting into one of these bunks. This bunk, as you notice, has one small hole at the top. I may have a little difficulty getting in with my clothes on, but I'll give it a try. Easy to float right up. Just jump in, pull it up around you. In this manner. We have armholes. We have an inner blanket, which is a loose netting if you want to sleep cool, and we have an outer blanket as well, which we can pull up when it gets a little cooler, which it does sometimes in the night around here. And these elastic straps are designed to keep you sort of restrained if you like them. Some of the guys don't like them, don't need them, but others like to have a little feeling of solid bed against their back, and so they use that. Get out of here now, and we'll go on to another area. But as I was pointing out, we all sleep very well in Skylab. We seem to require just a little bit less sleep here than we do on the ground, say maybe an hour less. Now let's move on around to the bathroom area, or the waste management compartment, as we call it in space jargon. This is the waste management compartment. In it, we have for going to the bathroom and for collecting our waste and processing it so that we can take it back to the ground. Also, we have wash-up facilities here, and this is where we shave and brush our teeth and so forth. Okay, this is our sink or hand-washing area. Here's our soap. It has a little metal tab on the back so we can fasten it to this magnet. It won't float away. We have hot water, too. There's a water heater above this, which holds about a gallon of water, and through this little spigot we can push it and water comes off. You see how it floats around and kind of clings to you. And it just clings to the sink area back here. When we want to, we just wipe it up. We have a way to squeeze out our wash rags using this squeezer. simply take a wet rag, put it in this little container, put the squeezer over and squeeze. Now the water goes down into a bag that's been evacuated, takes the moisture out, and we get a relatively dry rag, and then we can rinse off much as you would at home. As we move around to my left here, you'll notice that for those of you who lived on a farm in the good old days, in fact, this is a good old days for lots of farmers, we have a one-holer. This one-holer is somewhat different than the one that you're, however. As you know, of course, our one-holer is back on the ground, everything goes down. But the things don't go down here, so we have to treat it a little bit differently. You'll notice the other thing that's new and different about this is that it's on the wall, and that we sit on the wall to do our thing here in Skylab, and of course that doesn't make any difference. Simply grasp the handles firmly and put yourself in the proper position, and one thing you don't want to forget to do is to turn on your blower. Now the reason we have this blower is so that air can be sucked in this manner and take the contents and push it toward the back of the bag. And since it doesn't drop into the water as it does at home in your 1G toilet, we have to have this blower device to take the contents and take it to the back of the bag. And in here we have a bag that after we turn off our blower, we can seal around the top. Of course, all of this has to be analyzed by doctors back at home, and you can imagine that 56 days of this for three men would be a pretty big blivet. So what we have to do is dry it, and we have dryers for that purpose. Now after we have sealed this, we have first to determine what its mass is. Wet, its wet mass, and so we have a mass measuring device in this little compartment, and we take this bag with its contents, secure it to the mass measuring device. Turn it on, and it oscillates back and forth, and depending on how heavy it is or how massive, why it oscillates at a different frequency, which has been converted to a weight. We record that on the little tab on the bag, along with who it belongs to and what the time and date is, and then we dry this. This is dried by placing it into what we call a fecal dryer, and here you see we have six fecal dryers. For example, let's try this one right here. Now, it has a vacuum on it. Each one of these little dryers can be open to space vacuum. And the bag here is one that's been dried already. The bag has got a little filter in it. We place it in a fecal dryer, close the door, and open the vacuum valve. Now, to accelerate this process, we have a heater. We can set that heater on a timer. We can determine what the time is by the mass or the weight of the contents in the bag. And when the timer times up, the contents is dry, and it comes up in the form that you saw it here. We can then take this bag and seal up the little filter through which it was dried, take off this green tape, take this little flap, seal it together, and put it away for storage back home. The contents of the bag now are completely dry and ready for transport back home and analysis. And then, of course, we have to put another bag in here. Okay, we simply take a bag out of our bag locker, install it in here, and seal it in there in the proper manner, and we're off and running again. Now, we also, of course, have to urinate just like you do at home, and we each have to save a sample of our daily urine. So we each have a urine receiver drawer, which you use with the same blower that we use for the fecal collector. We can use this tube to urinate into, turn on our blower, and the air entrains the urine and takes it down into a bag, which is contained down into this drawer. And I can